Merry Christmas, church. Wow, here we are. Merry Christmas, church. Yes. On this last day of 2023, I wish to welcome all of you in the matchless name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I wish to tell you how thankful I am to be with you all, worshiping our great God and Heavenly Father in this beautiful space in His church. So before we do get to worship, let's all greet one another and say Merry Christmas to one another.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Welcome to Beverly Heights. We're so glad that you're here with us this morning. I'd like to highlight a few things for you. We will be continuing our regular worship schedule beginning next week with Christian education at 9 and worship at 10. A new class for adults will be beginning called Reading with a Christian Worldview. That'll be in the lounge with Rebecca Sparks. And so we hope you'll be able to come and join at 9 for Christian Ed. And there'll be classes, of course, for all of our younger kids as well. And 9 o'clock and then 10 o'clock for worship. I want to highlight for you that the registration for our preschool and academy opens up this week for our church families. So on Friday, January 5th, registration is open. So if you had some child that you wanted to register, I invite you to do so by going to our website and finding the preschool tab. Others in the community will be able to register in the next week or so after that, so you can certainly pass along the information that's in Gathered Seeds and pass it along to others so that they are aware of all the openings in classes that we have for the fall. If you have not yet picked up your offering envelopes and you have asked for a box, I invite you to pick them up. They're on the table right here behind us and also right next to the water fountain. And then also there's also a daily Bible reading calendar. If you are interested in following along with Robert Murray McShane's daily Bible plan that takes you through the whole Bible in a year, there are copies of this for you to pick up to follow along. He was a Scottish pastor in the 1800s and came up with a plan for reading the Bible in a year for his congregation to follow. And the women of the congregation used it last year, and we were really blessed by that. And so I made copies of this for everyone. If you're interested, feel free to pick up a copy. And then a reminder that the poinsettias are ready to be picked up. You can pick yours up today. Thank you.
At this time, I invite you to prepare your hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
Please join me in the invitation to worship found printed in your bulletin. Come, let us worship the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious God and loving Heavenly Father, we pray that you would gather our hearts as those who have come to behold the miracle of the incarnation, the baby born in Bethlehem. Gather us to yourself this morning and grant us that we may remain pure in our obedience to your word, made flesh in Jesus Christ. As we have waited upon you, O Jesus, this Advent, so we rejoice in your birth this Christmas. And we continue to wait with you in this final Advent. We pray that you would bind our hearts to one another and bind our hearts to you. We pray for your presence and your mercy and your grace. We pray that your grace would strengthen and build up all those who profess true Christian faith in this church and in every church, that we would be a holy people, set apart not only to hear your word, but to do your word, to do the works that you have given us to do in response to the grace and faith that comes to us in Jesus Christ. Open our eyes to see you and our hearts to love you and to know you and our minds to understand you this morning. Oh Lord, we pray this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to stand for our opening hymn of praise. Number 218, Angels from the Realm of Glory, verses 1 through 4. Please be seated.
Our Old Testament lesson this morning comes from the book of Psalms, Psalm 93, verses 1 through 5. The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He has put on strength as his belt. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their roaring. Mightier than the thunders of many waters, mightier than the waves of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. Your decrees are very trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore. This is the word of the Lord. Please join me in standing and continuing singing and worship, Angels from the Realms of Glory, verse 5.
As we do each and every Lord's Day, we come into the Lord's presence in His sanctuary, acknowledging our sin and our brokenness. James tells us that whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. And just as the shepherds came to see the newborn babe in the manger in Bethlehem, so we, like lost sheep, as our confession will say in just a moment, have gone astray. And so I invite you in this time to join with me in our unison confession of sin together, followed by a silent confession, saying together, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And apart from your grace, there is no health in us. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare all those who confess their faults. Restore all those who are penitent, according to your promises declared to all people in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may now live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Us from the scriptures. As we draw near to the babe in Bethlehem, so we also know Christ is the living water. And Isaiah says, with joy, draw water from the wells of salvation. And Paul continues, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen. Well, as we have been, has been our tradition here, as we have confessed our sin, we have also professed our faith. And for the entirety of Advent, we have been using the Chalcedonian definition of the two natures of Christ. But here in Christmastide, as is a tradition at Beverly Heights, we will recite the unison Christmas Creed. As we do, I invite you to stand as we say this together. Saying together, I believe that Jesus, the Word, was God, but he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. He emptied himself, took the form of a servant, and was born as a human baby. I believe he humbled himself and became obedient unto death. I believe God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. I believe that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every knee in heaven and on earth and under the earth. I believe that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Wherefore, I gladly join with my family of brothers and sisters in Christ, and I sing with joy that Jesus Christ is born. Alleluia. Amen. We'll continue singing a medley of carols at this point, which you'll find printed in your bulletin, beginning with 207, Good Christian Men Rejoice.
Jesus Christ is born today. Earth and heaven before.
please remain standing for our unison Christmas prayer, saying together, O Lord our God, as we celebrate again the feast of Christmas, we ask you to make us humble and loving like Jesus, who did not come to be served, but to serve, and who said that it is better to give than to receive, so that in his name we may devote ourselves to you in worship and serve those in need. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Special thank you to Kyungwon and Jenna and Kate. I am always blessed by your family's, entire family's participation in the music ministry of this church. Thank you for that offering today. Thank you. Well, it's good to be with you all this morning. We are still in Christmastide, which means we get to sing carols, which is great because we only get that a few weeks out of the year. And I'm glad we were able to sing so many this morning. We are concluding our Advent and Christmas series, The Sit Tights, Learning to Wait with the Messiah. Our text comes to us from Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 to 22, where Jesus is speaking to the church of Laodicea. And in so doing, he speaks to us. And so I invite you to follow along in your Bible, and as you are able, I invite you to stand for the reading of God's word. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments, so that you may clothe yourselves, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes, so that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for your word. Not only that you were born in the incarnation, but you continued your ministry and you leave us with your word here in written form. Thank you for your word to Laodicea and for your word to us today. May it grow and expand in our hearts and minds to change us, to transform us into your likeness. We pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. If you were to look out across the Lycus Valley in modern-day Turkey, a little over 2,000 years ago, you would see a prosperous and well-constructed city called Laodicea. It's situated along the main trade route of the valley. You can kind of see that green area there, that lush green area in between the mountains. Coming from Ephesus on the western coast and that trade route going along towards Colossae and even beyond that, Laodicea was famous as a wealthy center of banking in the ancient world, and it prided itself on being self-sufficient. After a large earthquake in 60 AD destroyed some of their infrastructure, Laodicea famously declined help from Rome. They said, we got it. We'll fund our own rebuilding. You would have seen a city that had a strong economy and likewise a strong culture. Laodicea is said to have produced a one-of-a-kind black wool that became known and used for high fashion back in those days. And so this is the city. This is the city our passage is directed towards this morning. In the beginning of Revelation, John sees a vision. He sees the exalted Christ standing in glory amongst seven lampstands. And those lampstands are seven churches, seven representative churches. And Jesus instructs John to write a letter to each of them. There's a general pattern to the letters. Usually, Jesus begins by commending the church for what it has done well, then rebuking the church for where it has erred, and then exhorting them to faithfulness, and then a promise for those who conquer. Laodicea is the seventh and final of these addresses. And like the other churches, Laodicea is addressed in its context. I don't know if you can see the names up there on the map. I tried to make them big, but Laodicea is the one on the bottom left. And to the north and to the west, it has two other cities nearby, Hierapolis and Colossae. Because of its location in the valley, Laodicea did not have its own water supply, so it had to channel water through aqueducts from both of these other sources, roughly 6 and 9 miles apart, respectively. Hierapolis was known for its hot springs, with water naturally stable at high temperatures. By contrast, the waters of Colossae were naturally cold and refreshing, and each of these had a pathway into the city. As these hot and cold sources of water traveled along the miles of stone piping to reach Laodicea, the predictable results were tepid. As the hot water from Hierapolis made its way into the valley, it would cool down. As the cold water from Colossae made its way into Laodicea, it would warm up. Along the way, the water would pick up minerals from the miles of stone piping, and so Laodicea was also known for its lukewarm and distasteful water. And this is the metaphor that Jesus picks up in our passage that he uses. As the water travels away from its source, it loses its character. It loses its effectiveness. It becomes lukewarm. And so our big idea is that faith removed from its source produces a lukewarm life. You see, the hot springs of Hierapolis were effective. The city was known for using their hot springs for medicinal purposes, to mend and soothe certain ailments. It was able to fulfill its healing purposes because the water was near the source of heat. But by the time the water would reach Laodicea, it was no longer hot. The medicinal property of the water, the heat, was gone. It was no longer effective for its intended purpose. In the same way, the cold water from Colossae was effective at the source. The cold and pure water that emits from a natural spring is refreshing and life-giving. In fact, the word used for cold in this passage is derived from the word for life. But the further away the water got from the source as it traveled to Laodicea, the less refreshing, the less cold, the less life-giving it became. After 9 miles, it was no longer effective for its intended purpose. In verse 15 of our passage, Jesus says, "I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot." He's not saying that hot water is good and cold water is bad. Sometimes we read this passage and think that Jesus wants us to be the hot water with the kind of fire of faith for him, and that being lukewarm is so bad that it would be better if we were so cold that we had no faith at all. It'd be better if we were just atheists than if we were lukewarm. He'd rather us reject him outright and be cut off than only be half-hearted. But that's not really what this passage is getting at. Jesus continues, "Because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth." Lukewarmness is a problem not because it's not hot, but because it's neither hot nor cold. Lukewarmness is a problem because it is ineffective. It's nauseating because it no longer fulfills either purpose. Either hot water or cold water is preferable because both are effective in their context. Both have a purpose. But the lukewarm water of Laodicea is trying to borrow the heat from Hierapolis and borrow the cold from Colossae, but they're too far removed from the source. Jesus is saying, "This is like you, church in Laodicea. You are too far removed from me, the source of healing, the source of life. And because of this, you are lukewarm. Because you are trying to borrow the healing properties of faith and the life-giving refreshment of the Spirit apart from me, you are tepid. You are ineffective. You are not fulfilling your intended purpose. Your life is lukewarm because you are too far removed from me, the source." But how did the Laodiceans get disconnected like this? Jesus says at the beginning of our passage that a lie crept into the church. In verse 14, Jesus calls himself the faithful and true witness. It's notable because out of the 7 churches, Laodicea is the only church that doesn't get a commendation from Jesus before moving straight to rebuke. Jesus is contrasting himself with the believers there. Laodicea has lost the faith. Jesus is the faithful witness. Laodicea has believed a lie. Jesus is the truth. But what is the lie? What is the content of that lukewarmness? Jesus tells us in verse 17, "For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked." The Laodiceans have believed in a false sense of security. They're too ready to believe in their own self-reliance. They trust in themselves first. The lie that they have believed is that they're doing just fine. "No thanks, Rome. We can rebuild without you." And that's good on them, frankly, I think. Good for them for having the resources. Jesus isn't rebuking their economic prosperity. He's rebuking their lack of awareness of their very real spiritual poverty. Their economic prosperity has blinded them to their spiritual poverty. That's why Jesus continues and says, "I counsel you, buy gold refined by fire from me, so that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may clothe yourselves, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes, that you may see." He's saying, you think you've prospered, but you don't realize your prosperity truly comes from me. You think you're clothed well, but you're naked, and what's worse, you don't even know it. Think back to the garden for a minute. Adam and Eve saw their nakedness, and they were ashamed. Their eyes were opened, and they beheld the bareness of their sin, and it was their shame, and they knew to cover it. The Laodiceans have regressed backwards beyond even that. Not only can they not see their sin, they don't even know that they have shame to cover. Jesus says, "Come to me. Your banks are nothing compared with the gold I will give you. My riches will outweigh all of your scales, but in order to have it, you have to come through the refining fire." Jesus says, "Come to me. Clothe yourselves in white garments of grace. That is the only thing that will cover your sin. You think you are covered in fine black wool and that your outward appearance makes you acceptable to the world, but you are naked and your shame is on display. I am the only one who can truly cover you and heal you." Jesus says, "Come to me. Let me anoint your eyes so you can see clearly. There is no one so blind as the blind person who thinks he can see, and that is you." They're tough words. These are tough words to the church in Laodicea. But why does Jesus say all of this? Why does he rebuke them? Verse 19, he says, "Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent." The Lord disciplines those whom he loves. And it's a refrain found throughout Scripture. When the Lord reproves his children, it's because he loves them. He doesn't want them to be lukewarm. He says, "Be zealous and repent," which means be hot and be cold. The word for zealous is the same as the word for hot earlier in the passage when it comes to the water. To repent is to be baptized in the waters of forgiveness, the life-giving forgiveness of Jesus. Don't be lukewarm, Jesus says. Be hot, be cold, be zealous, be repentant. Fulfill your purpose, be effective. Come close to your source. Verse 20, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me." The Laodiceans don't see that Christ is knocking at the door and offering them true nourishment, true communion, true riches and life-giving prosperity. They can't see him because all they can see is themselves. Their entire vision is eclipsed by their own lives and achievements and desires and their own pursuit of security. But Jesus says, "To the one who conquers, I will grant it. I will grant it to sit with me on my throne, to be secure, as I have conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." He promises that the one who overcomes the blindness, the one who overcomes the temptation, the one who overcomes the ways of the world, the one who accepts his grace and lives close to the source, will sit with him and rule with him in the heavenly places. We don't think about it much these days, but man was made to rule. Adam and Eve, mankind, was made to rule. Genesis 1:26 says, when God says, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion," or "let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." That's our intended purpose. That's what it means to be effective. But sin corrupted all of that. And here at the end of Scripture, we see Christ, the new and final Adam, seated on the throne, ruling. His promise is that our original purpose, our original effectiveness, is near at hand, because in him, connected to the source of life, both the hot and the cold, we will rule with him. When the sit-tights are over, there's no more waiting. The Messiah has fully come, and his kingdom has fully come. There is only the eternal present of our Lord Jesus Christ when we take up our place with him and in him that he has prepared for us. That is the glorious promise of the future with him. But until our time is finished here, until our time is finished on this earthly pilgrimage, we stand in and upon Christ's victory to do the good work he's prepared for us to do. And Jesus leaves us with a simple message from the Laodicean church. He says, "Be zealous and repent." The message to the Laodiceans is the message to us. These letters to the churches are Christ's letters to the church. They're representative. We are Laodicea. I am. We are. We're far too easily distracted by our successes or sense of self-reliance. We are far too often neither hot nor cold, believing that we're just fine on our own. I've got it. I've got everything I need. We think that we are rich and finely clothed. And of course, we are. Materially speaking, we are prosperous. The Lord has blessed us exceedingly. In the South Hills and in this church, even the economically least among us are still among the richest in the world. And for that, we should be grateful to our very gracious God. That's a good thing. But how often do we allow that good thing, the blindness of our wealth or the blindness to our wealth, to make us unable to see that the truth is, spiritually, we are poor and pitiable? Our sin makes us wretched in the presence of a holy God. Jesus says, "Be zealous and repent. Be hot and be cold. Stay close to me. Do not be disconnected from the source." When we trust more in our wealth than we do in the God who gives it to us, we are lukewarm. When we fear losing our position in the world more than we fear the Lord who made the world, we are lukewarm. When we believe that we're basically a good person, or that my personal piety will suffice, we are lukewarm. When we think, "I believe all the right things, and that's all that really matters," we are lukewarm. When we think, "I'm angry at all the right things, I'm angry at all the perversions in society, and that's enough," we are lukewarm. And here's the scary thing. Repentance is measurable. It's perceptible. It's not an abstract thing that only happens inside of our hearts, that doesn't manifest itself in our lives. Our lives are marked by it. Otherwise, John the Baptist would not have told the Pharisees, "Bear fruit in keeping with repentance." Jesus would not have warned that every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. It's not hidden away. The fruit of the Spirit is evident. It's love and joy and peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And when these things are present, they are manifestly obvious. We cannot fake them. The fruit of zealous repentance, of a hot and cold life, is marked by the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. And we can't manufacture it. The Spirit has to grow it in us. But we do cooperate in it. We have work to do. It's not ours to create, but it is ours to work. Adam and Eve made to work and keep. Adam made to work and keep the garden. Remember how Jesus begins his letter to the Laodiceans. "I know your works. You are neither hot nor cold." Sometimes we think we can't talk about works. We're good Christians. We're good evangelicals. We know that we're saved by grace through faith and not saved by works. We think that any reference to works is works righteousness. Our works cannot, will not, and never will be able to save us. Yes and amen. It is all of God's grace. We are never saved by our good works. But sometimes we forget that we are saved to good works. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Created for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. That's from Ephesians. The hot and cold that Jesus is referring to in this passage are the works of the Laodiceans. They are our works. What he doesn't see in Laodicea is the fruit of a life in keeping with repentance. The Spirit produces that fruit in our lives, but we have to work at it. The gospel cannot be earned, but it does promote our effort in response to it. So the question before us is, what do our lives amount to? What fruit is being displayed? What are your works? This is not a message to the unsaved, but to the church. You have been saved by grace through faith, so where is your heat? You have the source of life-giving water, so where is the refreshment? If we have the source and we have Christ, we can offer cold and refreshing water to those who don't know him. But we can't offer that water if we aren't standing by the source, if we aren't found in the source. If our faith is far from him, if we have wandered too far into the world, the only thing we'll be able to offer is lukewarm, tepid water, and people will spit it out of their mouths. We have to remain close to Christ. Our lives have to be anchored in the source. And if you were surveying your life and seeing an absence, wishing there was more love, wishing there was more peace, wishing there was more joy and patience and self-control, you are not the only one. It is never too late to repent. It is never too late to come to Christ, to renew your life at the source of all things. This is New Year's Eve, the time when people reflect on the year that has passed and make pledges for the year ahead. So what does our life look like looking back? What will it look like moving forward? This year has been especially trying for us at Beverly Heights. We continue to have real trial in our community. What will our works reveal? What fruit will we bear? That depends on how close we are to the source, on how close we are to Christ. What do we trust in? What do we rely on? Every day we are faced with that decision. And in just over a month, we will have an important decision to make as a congregation. How will we approach that decision? How will we approach every day and every moment leading up to that point? You want to know what the first step is? What the first step always is in the Christian life? It's repentance. If you ever wonder, where do I start? If you're ever unsure, where to begin? Repent. That's always the beginning. Jesus begins his earthly ministry. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He says to us here at the end of Scripture, be zealous and repent. We're never done repenting in glory when we're in the kingdom with him. But here on earth, we're never done. Jesus is knocking at the door. And the way that we open the door, the action that turns the handle, is repentance. And when we do this, Christ promises to enter in and to feast with us, to commune with us. And that is what's offered to you and to our church, communion with Christ. And to the one that overcomes, who follows Christ, who remains by the source, it is granted to sit with him on the throne. As we draw to a close this morning, we're going to take just a brief opportunity to do that. Why talk about repentance and not do it? At the end of 2023 and the beginning of 2024, why don't we end one year and begin another in repentance? There's no pressure from me. There's no pressure from your neighbor on any of this. We've already confessed corporately this morning. We're simply making a space, an invitation from Christ, who says, be zealous and repent. Come to me, renew your life at the source, and be healed. If you'd like to participate in this and you're physically able, I just encourage you over the next few minutes to take a posture of kneeling right there in your pew. Or you can join me up here on the chancel steps for just a few minutes. If you've trusted too much in your prosperity and not enough in Christ, repent. If you trusted too much in your outward appearance to the world and not the garments of grace that the Lord gives you, repent. If you have been blind in your own sin to the wretched state before God and not dwelling upon his grace that we have in Christ, repent. If you long for more spiritual fruit in your life, more love, more joy, more peace and patience, more kindness, more goodness, more gentleness, more faithfulness or self-control, whatever your ailment or your thirst, whatever your distance from Christ, the source, our Lord, turn and repent. Come to him and open the door. Gracious God and loving Heavenly Father, we come to you on our knees in zealous repentance. Oh Lord, how we love you and how we know we stray so easily from the source of life and healing as found and known only in you. We pray, oh Lord, that you would work in our hearts to refresh and to heal us, draw us to yourself, the source of all things, that we would offer your living water to all, to a world in need. Lord, we pray over this next year in particular, over all of the ways and every decision and every moment of every day, that we would choose to decide to remain in you at the source, to be zealous, to be repentant, and to walk in uprightness in Christ our Lord. Give us the strength. Refresh us daily. We love you. We pray this in your name. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward to receive this morning's offering. Lord, we give you thanks for these gifts and offerings which you have first given to us. We return them to you in great gratitude and humility. We pray that they would bear fruit for your kingdom, that they would bear fruit in ways that we cannot even imagine, 30, 60, 100-fold, that even in giving, we would bear the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, that you would be born anew in us. Thank you for these good gifts. We pray that you would receive them. We pray this in your name. Please stand as we all say threefold amen together.
Amen.
closing hymn, number 224, Go Tell It on the Mountain. Of dismissal. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have the strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace.